About a cow dung economy, wishing to go in for nuclear energy.
I remember many years ago when our beloved Homi, Bhabha,
was first interviewed by Time magazine. He was asked how it was possible that so technologically retarded a country as India could produce a scientist and other scientists as advanced and formidable as Homi. Homi gave the classic and perfect answer. It is true, he said, that India neither invented nor produced the motor car, the refrigerator, the airplane, nor did it manufacture these in the overwhelming quantities of other industrialized countries. But for hundreds of years, when the Indian peasant did not have to work, he sat in the shade of a tree and thought. He thought a philosophy of truth in life, and he thought as an artist in action.
Our first duty as scientists is to establish the truth.
Disastrous crash of an aircraft on Mont Blanc, the world of science and art has lost one of the most distinguished men of our times.
He was an aristocrat, out and out, and mostly, I mean, a kind of westernized aristocrat.
What do you mean by an aristocrat? I mean, this is something I just do not understand.
It's rationality and his way of getting things done.
If he liked the good things in life, yes, definitely. Did he have an artistic bend? Yes. To have things which work perfectly? Yes, definitely. Now, if that is your definition of aristocracy, I agree with you, but yes, he's an aristocrat.
Homi Bhabha had the good fortune to be a member of a family with a long tradition of learning. He joined King's College, Cambridge in 1927 and studied engineering. And in June 1930, he did obtain a first class in the mechanical sciences tripos and thereafter went on to work as a research student in theoretical physics. It was a period also of great interest and excitement in the world of theoretical physics. In October 1933, he published his first scientific paper. In this, he described the part played by electron showers in the absorption of cosmic radiation. He returned to India in 1939 and was appointed a reader in the Institute of Science at Bangalore in 1940, and 2 years later became professor of cosmic ray research.
Bhabha really wanted to develop another department of theoretical physics.
Why?
See, there was already a well-established, flourishing school of physics under Raman here,
Accordingly, in a letter dated the 19th August 1943 from Bangalore, I wrote to Mr. Tata that with lack of proper conditions and intelligent financial support hampers the growth and development of science in India, and suggested that the Tata Trust might take the initiative in founding an institute for fundamental research. This decision was taken more than a year before the atomic bomb exploded over Hiroshima.
Our first duty as scientists is to establish the truth. And in this matter, our responsibility to humanity transcends our allegiance to any state.
Divi Surya Sahasrasya Bhavet Yugapaduthita Yadi Bhasaruti Sasyat Bhasastasya Mahatmana Tatraikastham Jagat Kritsnam Pravibhakti.
Not so successful like Dr. Bhabha.
Well, they were operating in different environments, Prasamal. I
have not known Dr. Bhatnagar personally, and even Dr. Bhabha was a rather distant kind of a person. So what one can see more is, or I can see more, is phenomenologically seeing the way the institute, our institute has grown and how other labs have grown.
Well, this institute was first built around one man, namely Homi Bhabha himself.
On the other hand, the CSIR laboratory built by Bhatnagar, they started from the opposite direction, with buildings first and then selecting people to fit into some slots. Now, where Bhabha has succeeded, I think, is because of the philosophy adopted of growing around people.
Men are more important than atom bombs.
When the United Nations decided in 1954 to convene a conference on the peaceful uses of atomic energy, Homi Bhabha was unanimously elected as the chairman of this great conference. This address was notable for its long-range predictions.
I venture to predict that a method will be found for liberating fusion energy in a controlled manner within the next two decades. When that happens, the energy problems of the world will truly have been solved forever, for the fuel will be as plentiful as the heavy hydrogen in the oceans.
Now, with careful analysis, he could foresee situations way ahead of the time that he was in. For instance, for a man to say that when atomic energy becomes an economic proposition, India will not be found wanting in scientists.
This is a considerable achievement in a country in which the psychological atmosphere is such that in every other sphere, the moment we think of starting a new project, we immediately think of finding a foreign consultant.
The reactor reached criticality at 3:45 p.m. on August 4th.
I named this swimming pool reactor Apsara.
Here. Professor Venkatraman, what all different methods doctor adopted to overcome obstacles in the men's minds, in the bureaucracy, for the success of scientific research in India?
He plainly told the administrators that they are working for the sake of the scientists and for the sake of science and rather the sake of administration.
He realized that the existing procedures and rules were framed for an altogether different situation.
I wouldn't like to call mend or bend rules, but rather to use the existing rules and regulations to see that what you want done is done in a most expeditious and economic manner. That is all he was doing.
In fact, if you go through the details, the way he set up the Atomic Energy Commission, the Department of Atomic Energy, the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, you'll find that there is very little that you can change in it today without detriment to the function. And most important, he understood what was the atmosphere or the culture, the environment in which science would truly flower and deliver the goods.
You will come to the conclusion of the inevitability, the essentialness of our using the future, building up from now onwards, atomic power for these peaceful purposes.
Within the next 100 years, which is the least that we can expect, this would exhaust the known reserves of fossil fuels in under a century.
In exceptionally bad years of drought, and we had a succession of them in recent years, necessitating drastic power cuts. There were power cuts in 1953, 1956, 1957.
It shows the absolute necessity of finding some new source of energy if the light of our civilization is not to be extinguished.
Can you explain the secret of the success of the air power and the
compared
to other scientific?
His proximity to the corridors of power in Delhi. For example, for any director, it is necessary to go through the proper channel. Whereas Dr. Bhabha had to just clear one step, that is step to Jawaharlal Nehru.
No, that's carrying things a bit too far. You know, influence is all right up to a point, but until and unless a person has something in him.
He's a keen thinker. He got his facts and figures right.
I don't think that merely influence was responsible for the progress of atomic energy in the country.
Also Nehru helped him, isn't it? Nehru?
I believe the situation was rather unique in our history, in that there were two such dynamic persons who came to contact, who saw identity of views there as far as India was concerned.
I will say that he was the greatest gardener I have ever met in life.
More than a scientist?
I should think so. He was a gardener to the core. He always quoted Bombay should be the industrial Versailles of India.
It needed the courage of a great man of vision and imagination, with a profound belief in science and its importance for humanity, to launch an industrially underdeveloped country on an atomic energy program in an important way. If India today is among half a dozen countries of the world advanced in the peaceful uses of atomic energy, it is thanks to the policy initiated by our late Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru.
To people, as far as work goes, he was utterly ruthless. If the work did not come up to standard, he would dismiss his best friend.
I have learned a lot of things from him. How to behave with people, how to be punctual in our work, what sort of work we have to do. And
he was not very kind of dictatorial towards you?
Dictatorial means I could not.
As to the question of whether he was dictatorial, well, he couldn't stand nonsense. He was a man with very clear thinking. And if anybody came with very bully suggestions and statements or long drawn out meaningless programs, he could be very tough indeed.
Is it a fact that he was able to get the things done because of forcing a point?
No, that's entirely wrong. He was a kind human being when you came to know him. I can assure, he appeared very aloof and very distant, but once you came to know him, it's entirely wrong.
Fully.
How fully?
To the fullest extent that I've ever known any man take to life. He said we cannot prolong life, but so the only alternative we have is to live it to its fullest.
Rocket zooms up, leaving behind a trail of success.
Did he confide in you failures also?
Well, he had very few failures. And frankly, the only failure I can recall is of such an intimate character that I can't talk to you about it. It was when he failed in a particular relationship with a lady.
Who could be the woman behind Dr. Homi Baba?
The woman who was closest to him in life was his mother. From the earliest years, he was devoted to her.
What about lady friends?
Homi had many lady friends, and one or two of them were exceptionally dear and exceptionally close to him. But even they recognized that mother came first in his life.
He was never known to be in the state of being in love. Perhaps that's the only thing you've ever missed in life. Those who made wry remarks about a cow dung economy wishing to go in for nuclear energy, Dr. Bhabha convincingly explained,
if the other agencies concerned with industrial development had done as much in achieving technical self-reliance as this department has, we would not be in the difficult economic situation in which we find ourselves today.
Tarapur marks the beginning of the second stage of our technological revolution.
But nothing is reversible except death. Did you believe in God?
think in the letter he wrote to me, is quite clear that it was the end. In it, he said, one of the great realities, perhaps the greatest, is the finality of death, both for those who die and for those who live.